tonight at Town Hall, meeting the night of the national championship game. I told them just our stopgap. I figured everybody wanted to stop talking about 8:30 if you watch the game. Well, I want to welcome everybody out.
How are you?
If you're going to have a seat, we can start here in a few minutes. And thank you guys for coming out. I am Senator Michael Williams. I represent District 27, which encompasses most of Forsyth County. Sheri Gilligan, Representative Gilligan, is also here tonight. She's newly elected. Our joint town hall meeting tonight. We're going to start out with a prayer, followed by the Pledge of Allegiance, and I'll go ahead and offer the prayer. Our Father in Heaven, thank you for this evening that was blessed us with to gather together as a community to talk about the needs that we face here in Forsyth County as well as our
state of Georgia and our country.
Thank you for our Savior Jesus Christ, and for his sacrifice, and for the example that he has left us with, and the ability we have to repent of our sins and to be forgiven of thee. Please be with all of our elected officials, especially here in Georgia, that we will be guided and directed on the things that would have us to do. Thank thee for those that serve our country, and please be with them and their families. In the Savior Jesus Christ, amen.
My first year as a legislator. Today was my very first day to sit in my chair, put my voting card into the machine, and get to push the little green button saying, I'm here. So that was my exciting thing. I know it's so silly. If you follow me on Facebook, you see that's what I posted today, what was on my desk, and the fact that I got to vote. My name is in lights. So I never dreamed that my name would be in lights, so here I am. Now, for our legislative agenda, the most important thing to me and what I hold dearest is education, and it has been from forever. After I graduated college, I went up and I spent 20 years in the intelligence field, but when I came back down here, I was substitute teaching in the school system here, substitute taught at West here, and at Bickford Creek Middle. And then I taught at Levent Tech. So teaching and helping people learn is something that I thrive on doing. It's very exciting to me. So even in the intelligence field, I did a lot of training. I was helping people learn how to do the craft. So that was part of what I did. So education is a natural for me. And I am one of those people who is very suspect of what's going on with the federal government overreaching to our school system. I want the teachers to be in charge of the classroom, and I want the local board to have more say in what goes on. And I'm excited because we didn't recognize the elected officials here, but I did see Kristin Morrissey for the school board somewhere. There she is. And she's very active here in the community, and she also knows what needs to be going on in our schools, and we want to give her more authority in the school board. So that's what I would like to see. And I know that I saw some other, let's see, we have Representative Dudgeon somewhere. He's so tall, how can I miss him? There he is, because he was sitting down. We have Solicitor General Bill Finch. And I know that there were some other elected folks, and I'm probably just scanning the audience. Oh, Commissioner Todd Levent sitting right in front of me, which is why I can't see you. Is Commissioner Boff here? Oh, in the back, thank you. Anybody else that I am overlooking, because I am so good at missing everybody now. So go ahead and raise your hand, and you can throw darts at me another time. Okay, so like I say, education is the one thing that's very dear and near to my heart. Other than that, I don't have a personal legislative agenda. I'm getting emails on things that are important to you guys. I'm getting emails on things that are important to people who live in Griffin, Georgia, and Fayetteville. I'm really most interested in people in the 24th district and what's important to you, because I'm your voice. I'm not the person in Griffin's voice, I'm not the person in Fayetteville's voice, I'm the person from Forsyth County in the 24th district. So if you'll keep in touch with me, that would be wonderful. And so that I can keep in touch with you, there was a sign-up sheet in the back. Michael Williams, Senator Williams, and myself will share that email list with each other. If you decide that you don't want mine anymore, but you still want me to unsubscribe, and I'm sure he would say the same thing. And other than that, I am going to hush because politicians love to talk, and I have run out of time. But I will say that as we go through tonight, if you ask me questions, I will do my very best to answer them if I can. And sometimes the answer will have to be, I will look into it because I won't have all the facts. I just won't. But I will now turn it back over to Senator Williams. And if you did not get a chance to sign up on that sheet, he's got it in his hand, but if you still want to sign up, please let us know.
Thank you. Also, we announced all the elected officials that are here today, and we are about to be in the midst of campaign season with elections coming up, primary elections coming up in May. Do we have any announced candidates that are with us today? Want to stand up, just kind of introduce yourself?
My name is Rick Swope. I'm running for District 2 Commissioner.
And Greeter. All right, anything? Yes. Hopefully we'll be able to get that passed. Also, fireworks. Just by a show of hands, who here likes the fact that we legalize fireworks in the state of Georgia? A few, okay. Who does not like it? All right. We're working on some legislation not to make fireworks illegal again, but to put a few more controls in it, primarily sending it back to the local municipalities so that they can put some restrictions on it, on when we can shoot and all that kind of stuff. So we should see some of that coming out in the session as well. Also, casino gambling. There's been a little bit of talk about that in the news. I, for one, do not agree that bringing in casino gambling in the state of Georgia and tying it to Hope Scholarship is the right thing. Thank you. So that's something that I know I'm going to oppose. Also, how many teachers do we have in the audience today? Okay, a few. Not as many as the last town hall that we had. There was a report that came out that talked about tying teachers' pay to performance. As Representative Gilligan mentioned, we had our first day of session today, and that was probably one of the most talked about items in the halls and in the chambers was the reaction to this news. So I can't promise you anything, but I want all the teachers in here to know that you've been heard, and it does not look like we're gonna move forward this session with some of the recommendations from the governor. So just kind of keep your ears up. I know that you've been heard, and but there's probably gonna be some changes to that. Also, I don't know, on a personal note, the city of Sharon Springs and what I want to kind of call the debacle of communication that happened over that or over the past couple of months. I want to apologize for those people that are supporters of SSA in the way that I handled the lack of communication and some of the, I guess, circumstantial evidence that looked like there were backroom deals and all sorts of mishandling of things. So I feel really bad about it, and I've learned a lot. And what I'd like to do just for a couple moments is kind of share with you the thought process I had and how I came up with the decision to withdraw the bill of SSA. I know I put out a 20-page document that kind of explained back and forth of the communication, but in there I did not actually talk about my thought process. Whenever I ran for the Senate 2 years ago, one of the biggest strengths that I had was my background, business background. People always talk about how they want somebody with a business background knows how to make decisions, go in there and kind of do the right thing. As I was going through gathering all the information and looking at the pros and cons, that's the approach I took on it. Was if this was my business and I had this list of information, what decision would I make? And if I had a process that I had to, let's say a computer program that was going to make my business better, and at some point in time, I knew that computer process was not going to be viable for my business, I would no longer go after that computer process. I would say it's pretty much a dead end. To me, that's what happened with SSA whenever it was ruled that moving forward with the city light was not in compliance with the Constitution. I didn't want to waste anybody's time on going after something that was no longer a viable option. What I did not anticipate, what I've really learned, is that in politics, there's emotion. And there are a lot of people that are mad and that are angry and that are upset and that really wanted for their voice to just be heard. Whether or not it was going to work or not, they wanted to be heard. And that is what I discounted. So for that, I apologize. And I'm going to take that going on to the future. That's not always a black and white. There is a desire that people have to be heard. And that again, that's what I'm going to take from this going into however else I remain elected. So that's all I have for tonight. I'm going to turn the time over to you guys. We have the sign-up sheet. We want to kind of set a few ground rules on how we're going to handle this. We're going to give everybody 5 minutes, up to 5 minutes. You don't have to take the full amount, but up to 5 minutes to kind of share whatever you would like. And then also in doing so, We ask that you stick to the facts of the issues and not to attack anybody or any group personally. Let's strive to remain civil and not go there. And then also, depending upon some of the subject matters, if we start to hear the same things over and over and over and over again, what I would like for you to do is, when it's your turn to speak, just kind of come up and say, I agree with whatever has been talked about before. We don't want to take away your right to speak. We also want to be respectful of other people's time and all that. So again, it's something that's been talked about numerous times. Just agree with it. If something you want to add, definitely add to it, and then go from there. Any questions? Oh, yes, thank you. Here we have a microphone and a little podium over here. If you are more comfortable standing over there. Some people don't like being in front of everybody, so you kind of to the side. So you can go over there or you can come up here. So whichever is more convenient for you. Any other questions? All right, we've got it.
I have a question. Is it like open question?
No, if you sign.
Yeah.
Okay, we'll get to you. You're on here?
Yeah.
All right, we'll get to you.
Right. I thought I was missing my shot.
Yeah, no, it's a question about how we're going to do things. All right, Bob Rorke, you're up.
How's that? Good. Everyone hear me? Thank you. I have a little discussion to have with our state legislators. First of all, thank you very much for town hall meetings. We should have more of these. We should have them locally based. Should have them locally based as well as for the state legislature, because that gets one-on-one with our elected officials, and really we get to know them, they get to know us. But anyway, that's thank you for doing this. There's a conundrum that we have in Forsyth County, and for those who don't know what a conundrum is, it's a logical postulation that evades resolution to an intricate and a difficult problem. Just a little under 4 years ago, the Board of Commissioners that are elected to represent the people, unfortunately, they say they do it with this particular resolution they did. I don't think it's obvious that they did. So instead, they seem to do a special interest and less people focus. So on March 15th, 2012, the following commissioners, which was the commissioners at the time, they're still 80% the same commissioners as they were back in 2012, passed a motion resolving to implement practices, and this is right from the county record, necessary to address growth issues facing Forsyth County. So again, 80%, I'm not singling out anyone's names, but 80% still remain in office. So basically the resolution stated, number one, we will continue to ensure that the new and existing development is supported adequately by necessary infrastructure, particularly roads, schools, public safety protection, and wastewater and treatment systems. Two, we will ensure that new development does not cause a decline in existing levels of service for the community's residents and employers. Three, we will support the local school board and encourage school location decisions that sustain the community's overall growth and development plans. And four, the Forsyth County Board of Education will continue to provide quality education, programs, and facilities to the citizens of the county. I'd like to submit to all of you tonight, there was no intention by the Board of Commissioners to truly address the issues of growth on steroids, which have become a millstone around the people's necks here in the county. Our everyday existence, if those four points were truly addressed, would not be waiting in line, waiting at lights, going back and forth, trying to get around the county and the city. So they passed it by 100%. How's that working for us? Additionally, I believe that the plan to address the ever poorer quality of life burdened by us here, lived by each of the citizens, was to do just the opposite of what they intended their resolutions to do, and that was goose-step precision and in lockstep with all the business interests, so they wouldn't have to do that, but it made it sound good for us. So one might postulate, what are the logical solutions to a local government who is out of touch with balance between growth and quality of life, and not wanting to be 100% transparent, and the people who pay the bills, all of us. So, in closing, whatever the solutions that are discussed, recommended tonight, the citizens must be given citizen-centric solutions. But they're not going to be worth the paper they're written on, the recording that they're being recorded on, unless we insist with our state legislatures the following. And by the way, I don't know if you ever heard the latest thing that, you know, there's no appetite for this, there's no appetite for that. Every time we want something out of the legislature, we say, oh, there's no appetite. Well, we need to give them an appetite increaser so there is some appetite for the following items. One, give the people term limits for all elected and appointed officials, because what is good for the governor and the president is good for Julian. Two, give the people improved, defined, logical, and enforceable ethics laws and rules that clearly put all officials on notice that this is not your grandfather's Georgia anymore. Three, give the people sunshine laws that do not exempt the so-called discussions under the Gold Dome from the laws that are supposed to protect the citizens. Because every time our delegation of commissioners go down to the Gold Dome, there's no open records because they're exempt from it, from the state law. So, people want and deserve officials that are accountable, transparent, and totally honest. To have anything less is affront to us, the citizens. Thank you very much.
All right, thank you. Wendy Blond.
Patient that resident needs more frequent care. And so this doesn't preclude the resident from needing to see a dentist. They still would, and there's still a collaborative agreement. But what it would allow is for the hygienist, such as myself, to go there maybe the other two times or three times a year and see this individual and give them the care that they need, make them a healthier person while the dentist is still productive and providing services elsewhere.
All right, thank you.
Do you mind if I ask you a question? Do you know if there's a Senate version of?
There is not a Senate version of the same bill. There are two other bills related to dental hygiene down in the Capitol. One of them, the other two are scope bills. There's one in the Senate that's for a mid-level provider. House Bill 684 is not to change scope. It's not a mid-level provider. It's to utilize the hygienists that are coming out of our school, our dental hygiene programs across the state. But if there's an interest to introduce a Senate version, we would love to entertain that.
I'm not putting him on the spot either. I was just asking.
How would that be paid for?
So the question was, can I answer a question from?
Yeah.
Sorry, this is my first town hall meeting. So the question was about payment. So for like the federally qualified healthcare centers, the payment's already arranged. It's just that the hygienist is having to have the dentist there to do the services. So there are places that have that. Charity clinics would also benefit from this, where they're providing the services for free. But there's companies now that take dentist and hygienist into nursing homes that are providing these services. They're the ones that, in speaking with them over the last year, they've had to provide like six cleanings a year, and they're having the doctors just stand around while these hygienists are providing those extra services, which is a waste of our workforce. So there's already companies out there that have been doing this. They're reimbursing through the dentist and filing just like they would normally.
Thank you. Tony Gorilla?
Well, sometimes I get
First, I want to ask everyone, if you've been in Forsyth County long enough, you know that we used to vote commissioners based on an at-large basis, meaning that it didn't. What district you lived in, you could vote for any commissioner in the county, in Forsyth County, wherever you happen to live, and it made no difference. I'm not sure how long ago it has been now. It's probably been at least maybe 18.
It was a referendum.
Put on the ballot that was worded in such a way that most of us voted in favor of the referendum. That gave us what we now have today, that is voting for commissioner based on your district. So if you don't like what's going on in the northern part of the county or the southern part of the county as far as growth, too bad. You can only vote for your commissioner. I go back a long way with the growth issue, and there's a couple of commissioners that we started the same way. There's a couple of commissioners that are here who used to be on those early commissions back in the early 2000s. Ladies and gentlemen, we had the same problem then that we have right now. Nobody gives a rat's behind about whether or not there is traffic issues, there are overcrowding of the schools, or is overcrowding of the schools.
You mean?
There isn't an issue because the landowners, basically, and Emory Lipscomb's office, pretty much control everything that's going on in here. And I dare any commissioner to come up here that was on that that commission back then, or now for that matter, to refute them. So what we need to do is to go back to voting on an at-large basis. In order for us to do that, we need our representatives to make, to take the initiative, because based on a town hall meeting we had a year ago in this school, that question was brought up. Mark Hamilton, it was told to us at the time, had to bring that up for a, I'm not sure, he had introduced it in the House. It wasn't something that the whole House could vote in favor of or not. It just had to be brought up. I'm not sure how that works. Maybe you might know, maybe Senator Williams might know, but that's one thing that is needs to be done. It needs to be done before, if it's at all possible, November. Otherwise, we're screwed for another 4 years.
All right, just to kind of clarify a little bit about what he's talking about, there was a ballot question, I think it was 2008, asking about countywide versus district voting. That question, though, was a non-binding question. What that means is what the outcome of the question really had no impact on whether the legislator did it. It was just only for information purposes. So had it passed yes or no, nothing was binding. The House does not have to start the bill to go back to countywide voting. That can start either House or the Senate. So that's, I'm not sure where that came from, but it can be done in either chamber. The issue that we're facing with countywide voting is something called the 1964 Civil Rights Act, as well as several other bills that have been passed since then, that protect
minorities.
And I've actually done quite a bit of research on that. And if you want to do some of your own research, there's some sheets of paper back in the back of that table. There are 29 counties that have either the VOC, the VOE, or cities within the counties that are at district voting, which is where we are now, that tried to go back to countywide voting. They had the legislation was passed, and they had it, and then they were sued. And of those 29 counties, every single one of them, the courts overruled. And within the 29 counties, there are actually 47 different cases. 47 different cases where the courts, where the people, again, the legislation was passed to go back to countywide, and in 47 different times, the court said you can't do that. So I understand there is a strong desire for people to go back to countywide voting. I understand there's a feeling of misrepresentation and not feeling like your voice is being heard. We hear you at the state legislature. In fact, myself, Sheri, Representative Dudgeon, and Representative Duncan had a discussion today in our office about this very subject. And we're looking for solutions that will be long-term, not just short-term, that will resolve the issue at hand. And again, anybody that wants to talk to me about countywide voting, I can share some of the stuff I have. I know Representative Gilligan is pretty passionate about countywide voting, and she's looking into it even more in some of those cases. So it's something that we are looking into. But right now, just as I look at it, the facts are, even if we were to do this, the courts would overrule it. We'd be stuck right back where we are. And I'd like to come up with a solution that we can take with us this long term. Sure.
I wanted to finish up. I want to read something that maybe Senator Williams. Next week, the Georgia Senate will have the opportunity to end unrecorded votes on the floor. Amendments, that is what it is. It is important unrecorded votes are done away with because senators can hide their votes to avoid accountability. Nothing personal, just reading. An unrecorded vote last year is the reason legal aliens get Georgia driver's licenses. Now is the time to call your senator and ask them to support Senate Bill 674, which, to be honest with you, must have something to do with the unrecorded votes. And let me leave you all with one thing. We are responsible for the people that govern over us. If you have more, if you take more time, or you think it's more important for your kids' soccer, for your high school this and high school that, I understand that. I don't have any kids, and and I can probably empathize to some extent with people who have kids. But you cannot abrogate your responsibility to be aware of what's going on, not only in this county, in the state, in the federal government, because you deserve what you get. That's all I have to say.
Thank you.
Just real quickly, the unreported bill is what he's talking about. Every bill that passes through the House and the Senate has a recorded vote. As the bill comes onto the floor, there's a debate, there's possible amendments. An amendment can be passed or failed with the raising of a hand instead of actually pushing the buttons which record the votes. So the body, members of the body, they can ask for a recorded vote. It only takes five senators, I'm not sure how many reps, it only takes five senators to ask for a recorded vote. And if five senators ask for it, then it has to be recorded. If five senators do not ask for a recorded vote on amendments, you can just raise your hand and hear your name. And that's what he's referring to. I am not familiar with SB 674, but I will definitely look it up and then look into it. You guys, are you all on the list? All right, Stacy Ridings.
I'm grateful for this opportunity to stand and introduce myself. I am Stacy Ridings, R-I-D-I-N-G-S, and I am the Forsyth County Chairman for Trump for President. And I want you to know who I am, and I'd like to offer you the opportunity to volunteer in any way if you would like to. And I'd also like to offer you yard signs, bumper stickers, anything that we have. So thank you so much, and we'd love to have your help. Thanks a lot.
All right, thanks, Stacy. Larren Holt.
She has tried the ketogenic diet, which is a very strict diet where all of her food is measured in grams. She has 3 grams of fat for every gram of carb and protein combined. We have to make her food like that. That didn't help her seizures. And we've also tried chiropractory, and that didn't help either. By September of this month, she was having over 100 seizures a day. And we ended up in the hospital in non-convulsive status epileptus, which meant she had a seizure that lasted for, it was non-convulsive, so she was in a catatonic state. We were sent home from the hospital and just asked if we would be able to care for our daughter in the state. They had nothing else to offer us. I have been active last legislative session in House Bill 1's passage, and we knew that was an option for us. We just really did want to make it the last thing we tried, because it is not a regulated medicine. We would not have the option to purchase it in our state. So we went to your doctor, and he approved us for a medical marijuana card for our daughter. And we found a source to purchase that for her. And after we got left from the hospital on September 25th, we began her on cannabis oil. We added it into in addition to her diet and her other medications, so it's an add-on for her. By October 8th was the last seizure we saw. She is in ballet, she's at preschool, she got to go skating with her brother and sister, which would not have been possible. I would like to thank Senator Williams for his vote yes of House Bill 1 that even allowed us to do that. But this year we're asking for the ability to have the medicine grown in our state. We have a great agricultural state. I would love for the state to get the benefits of the tax money that we're spending to buy this. And I would like to not be breaking federal law by bringing my daughter's medicine back across state lines, because marijuana is still a Schedule I drug. My doctor can't prescribe it, he can't give me advice. This bill sets up a framework for allowing pharmacists to be part of the process and help us to know about drug interactions and things like that. Right now we're just feeding off of each other and parents, and I don't mind sharing that my medicine comes from a mom in South Carolina who out and make medicine available. She is making the cannabis oil and selling parents, so that's how we get it. So House Bill 722 would allow for limited licenses for a minimum of 2 and a maximum of 6 medical cannabis producers in the state of Georgia. It would track the seed to the plant, to the medicine, so it would be accounted for throughout the whole process, both to when I would get it for my child. It would still contain limited medical conditions. Last year under House Bill 1, there were 8 conditions approved for medical cannabis use, and this would add some more, including post-traumatic stress disorder for our veterans, and they've been pretty vocal about needing us to help them get through that process. There would be still no smoking allowed, so it would not be smoking cannabis. It'd still be in the oil form. No dry flower or smoking would be allowed, just by liquid filler oil. There'd be a strict regulatory structure administered by the Department of Health. The patient has to be certified by the physician still, and the product tested by an independent third party, which is so important when you're giving your family member, your patient, money, medicine, that we know where it's coming from and what's in it. 84% of Georgians have been polled to approve of medical growth of cannabis in state, and I'd ask that my representatives would support it as well. Thank you.
Hey, John Burt.
Thank you, sir.
Just a reminder again, let's not make things personal. I know Lauren, you did, but just as a reminder.
I'm sorry.
That was not direct at Lauren's story whatsoever, please. No, that's not what I meant.
Hey, I'm John Burton, and I live in Windermere, grew up in Dunwoody. I've got a wife and 3 kids, and I love Forsyth County. The problem I've got, Michael, I love your idea of impact fees, is that, you know, they're working on South Forsyth. I got 2 kids over there. And I hear that as soon as construction is finished, there'll be over capacity. So I got my kids over there in school, going through construction zone. You know what's impacting these kids' educations. It's gotta be. Why not? I think it's a wonderful idea. I'm one of the guys who gave $100 to the Sharon Springs Alliance. How that didn't work out, it's over my head. I've talked to my neighbors, they said, oh no, it's just more government. Some of my neighbors say, hey, I'm giving money too. Then we hear it's all shot. What I wanted to communicate to everyone here, I am way under Senator Williams' capacities and a lot of other people in this room. However, I'm considering moving. I can't stand a lot of the overcapacity that I see happening. Every party I'm at, every friend, you know, social event, all the guys that look just like me are saying, hey, it won't be long before the trucks will be shooting from 85 across Georgia 20 and you know, it'll be this outer perimeter, and so we're all freaked out. I'm not afraid, like people talk about afraid of terrorists. I'm not afraid of any terrorists anyway. But I'm hating that I love where we are, and I'm over here talking about moving. So the reason I'm here tonight is to say, hey, if anyone had any question about it, please know I'm not alone. I don't know what to do. I truly don't know what to do. And I'm not the kind of guy who's just going to run, but I don't know what else to do. So anyway, that's my message. I wish the best for the county. Truly, I do. Thank you, Michael.
Just to explain very, very quickly what happened with the Sharon Springs bill. The Constitution of the state of Georgia allows for the creation of cities. And within the Constitution, it gives us the cities the ability to do 14 plus services. The bill that was dropped to create Sharon Springs limited the city to only three. So you have the Constitution that says a city can do 14 or more, and then you have a bill that says it can only do three. There's a conflict. The Constitution always wins. So that's why the bill for HB 660 or 660 is going to be withdrawn. The good thing, though, is the state of Georgia and the legislature realized the need for not a full-blown city. Towns, villages, where communities can have more say in the zonings and in the land use of their communities. Again, today, the four-year legislators, myself, Sheri Gilligan, Mike Dudgeon, Jeff Duncan, we're talking, and the possibility for a township or a village is a very real possibility. There are forces that be that are trying to push through a constitutional amendment that would create towns and villages here in Georgia. So that means if that happens, as soon as next year, we can move forward with another bill. So there's light at the end of the tunnel. There are things that are happening. And also I know that the Board of Commissioners, I know they hear you guys' voice. I know a lot of times you don't believe it, you don't see it. I've had some discussions with several members of the BOC, and trust me when I tell you, they hear you, and they're trying to do different things to help you guys out. But in any event, you don't believe them, at the state level, there are things that we're moving forward as well. So don't give up hope. That there's still opportunities. Mark Weiss.
Thank you. My name is Mark Weiss.
Thank you. My name is Mark Weiss. And I do understand about the growth and how people feel about our county and our county commissioners. One of the things I've been reading is that a county-wide adding a sixth.
We can't hear you.
Okay. One of the things I've been reading is that they want a sixth commissioner wide. First, I do not believe that. One is you get an even number of commissioners. That's not good. Second thing is you grow government. That's not good. One of the suggestions I would say to do is let's keep five commissioners. Let's do three district, two county wide. That would give the theory that every person in this county would have three votes, three commissioners that represent them. I believe that will take care of your department with the NAACP on that problem. I think we should bring it up to the people in county on the primary, put it out there on the board, give the options, and let the people vote for it, and then take it from there. Thank you.
Tony DeMaria.
Lawsuits by developers whose applications. My thought, three things, very simple. SSA, that one gentleman, and I'm sure others, I get 100 notes. Those people wanted, as Michael said, they wanted to be heard. And guess what? They weren't being heard. The same in District 3. I know our organization, Citizens for Responsible Growth, we encourage people to listen, to find out what they wanted. And all they wanted, as Michael said, was to be heard. And they weren't heard. So, that's not dead. This township thing may be coming, so let's hope it is. Second point. Countywide voting, also at large. There's a list up there, 29, and I don't want to embarrass you, Mike. There's a list up there of 29 court cases against it. However, take a look at the dates, 1980, 1975, we were just getting rid of segregation. So we have all these court cases come up because the African Americans weren't allowed to vote. Simply put, that's why 29 went down the hill. Recently, the document states Fayetteville, or Fayette County, one district down there, the commissioners said, no, we're going to go back to countywide. The district itself was majority African American. Forsyth County has 15% minority. Fayette County has 30% minority. So we were told that, oh, we're going to break the Constitution. It's not constitutional for us to have countywide voting. Well, here's a question. Let's turn it around. In the first eight years I was here, maybe 7 years I was here, I could vote for any commissioner, all the commissioners, and they could vote for anything in my district. All of a sudden, our legislators, supported by our BOC, our commissioners, they said, no, tell me you can only vote for the guy in your district. But all those other people, all those other commissioners, they can vote for you. Now, none of our legislators have tried to go to the legislature and say, hey, Tony, you were wronged. You and everyone here was wronged because you lost representation. You can't vote out these bad folks. So, third point. We're talking about a sixth commissioner, maybe a seventh. I talked to a political advisor. He had a good idea. He said, let's go to 10. We'll go to one countywide and nine by district. And we talked and we giggled and we laughed. Then I finally said, you know what? I said, 2016, we have three commissioners coming up for re-election. If you go look at the voting, the zoning voting that goes on, or go look at Castleberry Road, when three commissioners said, we're gonna rip up one of the prettiest roads in Forsyth County. We're gonna spend $25 million on a road that has no traffic. And all the people in District 2 and 5 voted for us. Forget about a 6th, a 7th, or 10th. Let's get our butts out and let's vote out. There's constantly at least three that are saying three to two, we want this zoning. 3-2, we want Castleberry Road. Let's throw those bums out. We can do it. And things will go a lot faster. So, sorry to get animals. One other thing for a very good who's here in this room, I think. The Post Road Committee for Proper Development, I can't remember his name, but Kristin, you remember. He gave a speech. Yeah, Jim Compton. He gave a speech on countywide voting. He gave a speech on the five commissioners. It was great. It's, again, well, If you contact me, I'll get it for you. But it's, we'll probably see, put it on our website. It was such a good speech on countywide. So thank you very much.
Okay, thank you.
Just a couple of comments real quick. He is correct. There were a lot of cases in the 1980s. There are some in the 2000s as well. And yes, there's a lot of those cases where the counties are predominantly African-American, but there are six counties where it's not. For example, Effingham County, they were 85% Caucasian. So they're the same place that we are here in Forsyth County. So again, there is precedent for our county and the court to overturn it. Mary Helen McGruder.
Great opportunity for our county to come together and have an opportunity to meet, talk with each other and hear from each other. One of the questions that keeps coming up is what is wrong with Forsyth County and what's our state delegation trying to do to help us? I've asked several of you that question and no one's been able to give me a definitive answer. I've heard what's making one group or another unhappy, and we've certainly heard some of that tonight too. But I haven't heard how the changes that some people are putting forward at this time will address any of these concerns. This isn't to dismiss anyone's concerns as not real, because they are. But my question is, how does changing our county governance fix the current crowded schools or the long traffic lines? It seems that both of these issues could also be solved at the state level. If impact fees could be imposed for schools instead of using an antiquated school funding system, which is now in place, we could have avoided many of these trailers which populate our school campuses. And thank you, Senator Williams, for announcing tonight that that's going to be one of your agenda items. I think that will go a long way to helping a lot of our problems. We're told that funding is hard to get for road improvements, so our Board of Commissioners proposed and passed a local transportation bond so we can fix our own roads. We just hoped we could get assistance from the state. Regretfully, some of our delegation voted against that assistance when the time came, but again, thank you, Senator Williams, for your yes vote for transportation. We have gotten millions of dollars in state matching funds from that one bill and one bond to start working on the roads in Forsyth County. Actually, if you look at some statistics, you'll see that in Forsyth County, we're doing pretty well. Our unemployment rate is 4.4%, when in the state of Georgia, it's 5.6%. Our poverty rate is 7.6%. The state of Georgia, it's 18.2%. 85% of Forsyth County residents own their own homes. Our median household income is $85,000, and 91% of those in Forsyth County 25 years or older have graduated from high school, when in the state of Georgia, that percentage is 84%. Another little known fact to those of you who weren't here in the 60s and 70s, like some of us were, is that we were very poor. The state of Georgia wanted to offer incentives for counties where companies could come locate in our underdeveloped, poor counties. A study was done and counties were rated by income level and unemployment for these incentives. And Forsyth County was among the 20th lowest counties in the state of Georgia. As a matter of fact, we were the fourth lowest county in the state of Georgia. And you can imagine that the state of Georgia was not very high in national rankings in those figures either. Fast forward to today, Forsyth County is now in the top 20. Actually, we're the 13th. So while you sit there and say, this is great, let me tell you one more thing. It's not the 13th in the state of Georgia. We're 13th in the nation in income levels. We've come a long way since 1970. We're also told that counties of similar populations in Georgia have elected chairmen of their board of commissioners, and we should aspire to that also, and that our delegation is looking to make that happen. Perhaps we might do better to brag about how well our county is doing in comparison to those other counties. We might want to encourage those other counties to be more like us. After all, we're the ones with low unemployment rates, low poverty rates, well-educated, and well-to-do citizens. Is adding a sixth commissioner going to change that? Is a countywide elected chairman going to make a difference? We're told that something will be put in place this session this year. That would mean that there's an anticipation of another member of a board, a chairman, or some other idea. Is it really fair to our voters to ask someone to qualify in March for a position in a May primary? We have a lot of qualified people in Forsyth County who could run for office, but they need a little more notice than 6 weeks to decide what the impact would be on their families and their businesses. It's unfair to a county to do that to them. We're blessed in Forsyth County. We're blessed with hardworking, high-achieving citizens who are willing to pay for their community to be one of the best in the state. We have elected officials. Some of those from the past are here tonight, and some from the present. They've worked hard to be responsive and responsible, and they have served our county well. Certainly, there are areas for improvement, and the proposed update to the UDC will address many of those current concerns. We've been told we can't name names, so I won't name people who are here tonight who are on the proposed UDC committee, but I'm sure those who are here will work hard to make sure that those changes will make a difference that we're all looking for. There are other zoning changes also being proposed, and hopefully those will move forward to help solve some of the issues that are of concern to all of us. We're asking you as citizens to work on the state of Georgia. Work on our budget, our health care, our school impact fees, our HOPE scholarships. We have problems here, but they are everywhere. And it's healthy for a community to come together like we are tonight, face those problems, and come up with solutions. But let us do that as a county, working together. Let us be part of the solution. Don't just tell us what we're going to do. Thank you.
Thank you. Julian Bowen.
I think if I realized I was going to speak when I left the house, I'd dressed up a little bit. Only had time to shave and wash my hair, and I really chose to shave. I got all my chores done, though. Athens the other day, I went to meet a friend, and I drove home, and I decided I'd stop at Braselton. Had some friends there. Couldn't find their house. There was a road there. Well, I went down to Billy Holder's old story today. He wasn't there. I was lost. I drove up to Chestnut Mountain. Didn't look the same. I'd been there 2 or 3 years ago. Drove over to the vineyard. Boy, that's a nice place. Came down to Flowery Branch. That's changed. My goodness, I got a 5A school, going to be a 6A school next year. came to Hamilton Mill. Used not be nothing there. I couldn't find a plot of ground that wasn't built on. Went to Buford, to Rest Haven. Buford, just like here. Came into Cumming, just like in Brazel. It's this way all over the Northern Arc. And we've got to adjust to it. If you want to move, I'd suggest North Hall. I'm thinking about my grandson going to North Hall next year. He's in Stevens County, but Tocoa, my goodness, Tocoa's a great town in the 40s and 50s. It's poverty-stricken now. Population's declining. All the houses don't have anybody living in them anymore. They're all dead. I'll soon be dead. There's a lot of things going on that you need to think about. And usually, the things you think about, what's good? We've had a five-man board since forever. Gosh, the fussing and fighting. How many times have me and Michael been trying to kill each other? No, seriously. It don't always work out. It's not a bad place. It can be better. But we don't need to be hollering and screaming at one another. Maybe it's my old age. But think about that. We've got good people. I love Sheri. We can work this out. That's all I got to say. Greg Dolezal.
Thanks, Michael. I wanted to come grab this microphone. Because about a year ago, I had the opportunity to spend a day at the SEC Championship and did so with a fine young man from our community. And a few months later, that young man had a pretty tragic accident, actually. He was in a coma for a couple of weeks and didn't know what was going to happen, didn't know what was going to come to him. And, a lot of us prayed for him. A lot of us were aware of what was going on. And so I was so encouraged tonight to walk in and see Anna Williams greeting us and welcoming us. And I would just like to publicly say we're so thankful for your healing, your recovery. Wish you the best in the future. People like Anna are the reason that a lot of us do what we do, right? It's the next generation that we have so much hope for. And I wanted to come and address you all. I live in District 3, which is here. And I have the privilege to represent you on the Planning Commission for about 2 years. And it was honestly a fantastic opportunity. I got to meet many of you. I worked with a great board. I was appointed by a fantastic commissioner, Todd Levent. And Commissioner Levent asked me to serve for an additional 6-month term. And we figured that would be a formality. And oddly enough, that was denied 3-2 by the Board of Commissioners. We were not given the opportunity to have our commissioner pick his person for the Planning Commission. So when we talk about county governance, that's what the problem is. It's people who we can't vote for inflicting their will upon us. If Commissioner Levent is gonna be the only person that we can vote for, I think it's only reasonable that his person that he wants to be on the Planning Commission is appointed. What happened to me has never happened before in Forsyth County. And you might ask yourself why. Well, we have a few ideas, and in fact, one of the commissioners who voted against us stated the reason for that. You see, I have become troubled by some of the trend lines that I see happening in our county. And Mary Helen's exactly right. We have a fantastic county. We are very, very privileged to live here. Some people work their whole lives to be able to get the resources to move here. And so we're proud to be here. And we want to protect that. We want to preserve that. We want to make sure that things that make this county great continue on for the people like Ammon and the next generation so they come back to live here. So I had noticed that our bond debt had increased in one commissioner's term from $40 million in debt to $800 million in debt in county. One elected official told me a couple weeks ago that we're going to need an additional $500 million of school debt to build the schools to catch up or to accommodate the growth that is headed our way. That's about $1.3 billion in debt. This isn't the federal government, this is just for Forsyth County. However, that's a significant chunk. Your portion of that debt that you're sitting on today is about $10,000. And we don't see anything happening to improve that. In fact, you look around the county, you look at the communities that made District 3 great, you look at Polo Fields, you look at even some of the higher density neighborhoods like Vickery, you look at Westbrook, you look at Three Chimneys, you look at Bridal Ridge, you look at some of the golf course communities, St. Marlow, the things that put a stamp of identity on Forsyth County. I would like to ask you, the new communities that we see going up, can you show me one new community that matches that description? Because what I see is clear cutting land with literally without a single tree left standing. I see us changing the tree ordinance to put, I believe, a 2-inch tree in place of these other trees. I see 60% of our kids in overcrowded schools. Anybody get their tax bill? Anybody see their tax bill go up this year? We all faced a tax increase this year. In fact, taxes have increased in this county about 13% over the last 5 years alone. So anyway, I saw that. I was troubled by that. I was a voice on the Planning Commission that voted for zonings. Not wasn't the only voice, but I was one of the voices that voted for zonings that comply with the Unified Development Code, because I figured the code's there for a reason, so we might as well follow it. Some of those votes were overturned at the Board of Commissioners level. But I wrote an open letter to respond to a public official and to point out, hey, our taxes are going up, our schools are crowded, our traffic is problematic. In fact, Castlebury Road that Tony mentioned before, our county metric to widen a road to four lanes is 14,000 cars a day. Castlebury Road has about 7,000 cars a day, but we're spending $25 million to widen it. So I wrote an open letter. I guess I spoke truth to power, and the answer from the Board of Commissioners was to remove me from the board. Again, something that's never happened again in this county. So I'm going to continue to pursue a positive agenda for this county. I wanted to come before you guys as your former planning commissioner and let you know that. We're going to have some announcements in the weeks to come of what's coming for the future. But I'm so encouraged by the engagement in this community. I'm so encouraged that people see something here that is worth preserving. And for Michael and Sheri, I guess the one thing I would ask of you in this legislative session is keep our taxes low and our liberty high. Thank you.
The onus back onto the county governments, allow the county governments to do the ordinances so that the noise ordinance would be able to be complied with at the county level. So instead of the state having one thing that fits everything in the state, because 159 counties, we are a huge state, what works well in Houston County doesn't necessarily work in Forsyth County. So we're looking for solutions at the local level, and I do believe that we'll come up with something very reasonable, because you know we will be altering that law. I don't know what it will be yet, but I'll be glad to keep you posted on everything. Okay, so that was Cecilia. So Gina Vernola is next.
That's all I have. Oh, yes, I do have one more thing. The people
that live in the suburbs, we live here. Why? Because we like the open space, we like to garden, we like the trees, etc. If you want to live in a city like Avalon, pseudo city, or Vigory, another pseudo city, or all these little communities that are going up, where you go like this, live in the city. Don't come to this community, wipe it out, and do what's going on. I'm sorry, but how I feel, again, the way a community is shaped and configured can lead to destruction, and our quality of life is being infringed upon.
Thank you, Gina. Is Beth Timpton?
As some of you know, in early December, we announced the formation of Bethel Butte Alumni. The reason that we announced that formation is because many citizens in the West Forsyth area, like those in the Sharon Springs area, were very concerned about the amount of unbridled growth in our area. Very concerned that our Board of Commissioners were not hearing us. In District 3, Todd Levent, he listens to us very often, and yet we have three commissioners because of district voting that consistently vote against him and therefore the will of citizens. I don't think any of us want to add another layer of government. However, there is an air of desperation growing among homeowners. I think we are underestimated. When the Sharon Springs bill was withdrawn, we were asked if we would continue with the Bethel View Alliance. And I want to say that nothing has changed with the resolution that was negotiated with our state delegation. We still have tremendous debt. We have overcrowded schools, roads that are unbearable at times. They are impacting the quality of life. People realize that when it takes 20 minutes just to get to the grocery store or an hour and a half to get home, that there is more to life than sitting in traffic. We don't see anything that happened with the board resolution that will solve any of our issues in the near future. We really need representation. We feel unrepresented. And we hope that, Michael, that you will support homeowner candidates. I would like to ask if you've used your email distribution list to support Rick Swope and Kelly Warren. What can you offer us that gives us any hope? Because right now we don't see it. And Bethel View Alliance will talk to citizens. We will be looking at our options because we don't see light at the end of the tunnel, honestly. I don't know that formation of the city is what we'll be looking at, but we don't need elected officials helping us, and we need help. So we're going to help ourselves until we see evidence that we have an ability to vote people out of office that don't represent us, or the ability to have a promise made by our elected officials and have it kept. So I would, like I said, like to know what you're doing to help our candidates that are homeowner friendly.
Well, first of all, the Homeowners Coalition, I'm not sure how many times that's been kind of used tonight, but that is one of the most organized and well-funded grassroots organization that I have personally ever seen. I have a small little confession to make. Sherry's aware of this. My consultant actually ran the campaign of one of the guys that ran against Sherry. I had lunch with him one day, and I was telling him, I said, Seth, you are completely underestimating this homeowners coalition group. You have no earthly idea what you're up against. They are going to kick your butt. And that's exactly what happened. Sherry went 75% to 25. The homeowners coalition was behind me as well. And we beat an entrenched incumbent 66% to 34%. So Beth, you guys are out there and you're doing it right now. Even though a lot of the coalition is not in the district that Sheri serves, they still campaigned and helped raise money and did all kinds of stuff to help get her elected. There are three commissioners that are up for election this May, the primary. Just because they're not your district commissioner does not mean you cannot go out there and find a district commissioner that you like in another district and work your tail off, contribute to them, and campaign for them. So my answer is, you guys are mobilized, you guys are organized, get out there, work your tails off, and get the commissioner you want elected. I've already come out very publicly against one of the commissioners. I sent out an email, I've done on Facebook, I've come out pretty hard against one of the commissioners, and I committed that I would support a homeowner candidate for District 2. So that is what I've committed doing, and again, just encourage you guys to keep working. Just because, again, you can't vote for that district commissioner does not mean you cannot work a campaign for the candidate you want in there, just like any other House or Senate seat.
Fine, the space is speaking for it.
Are you saying that you are going to support?
I have not sat down and had a one-on-one with either one of them. I've talked in passing and stuff like that, so today I'm not prepared to say who I will support. But I have publicly committed to support a homeowner center candidate in District 2.
Michael, as one of the members of the Homeowners Coalition, I can assure you that, like Beth said, we will be asking you to publicly tell us where you stand.
I do not doubt that one bit.
and Michael, we have your confidence to be helpful because we think when you get your head once in a while, all flies just right. Okay? Right. You really see what's going on.
Larry,
we
difference.
Look forward to
it. Two and four. Dr. Buff here, better mic.
Hi, I'm Larry Duckworth from actually District 5, Grand Cascades, over by the Chattahoochee River. I want to really deal with two or three points tonight. First of all, Tony, our Civic Affairs Committee at the HOA, we allocated some money, so we're going to be sending you guys some money. And to help out, and you know, I've worked with you in lots of different campaigns. And the zeal of this group overcomes dollars 10 to 1. So we really need to understand zeal is the best currency we can have for any of this stuff. So everybody needs to get zealous, get involved, call, give money, wave signs, put signs up, et cetera, because that's really what it takes. And we've seen the result. These elections have become real. Now, 2 points. For 11 years, I was a management service outsourcer for county governments and so forth, so I've seen a lot of stuff. All of them are going through this at-large discussion section. I'm a big fan of at-large every time, if you can do it, because all ships rise at a rising tide, all those representatives really vote for the greater good of the community, etc. Now, always the issue, the issue you raise, I think, well, Grant said, in every battle, both sides at a time think they're going to lose. Who continues the attack wins. So, it took Edison 754 times to get tungsten. The issue is that always in these fights, you had to have three conditions where you had a large percentage of minority in a specific area, and a candidate would run but could not get elected. And when that happens, then there is bias, there's a technical term. I don't think we have that here. No candidates run, they're not concentrated, et cetera. I believe you can win this fight. It's gonna take some stuff, but I do believe you can win this fight. And so I've seen it before. So I'm a fan of at large, for sure. My good friend Jim Boff, I'm in District 5, I campaign for him all the time. And by the way, he and Todd Levent are the 2 versus 3 all the time. And we ought to really thank those guys for helping us stand up. The issue is, now there's been talk about one or two more. I submit that would be a fox in the hen house. And I say that because to run countywide, you have to raise a lot of money, more than you do in a district. That opens up them up to being dependent on this insidious cancer we have of the fast growth club. I think these people have to go out and raise that money to do that. They'd be dependent on them. So instead of 3 to 2 votes, we'd have 5 to 2 votes. And so I really think we got to watch out and be careful what you wish for. You might get it. So let's go back to this at large again. Jim told me the other night that Mike Dudgeon had another good round on Thursday night. That Jim is correct, the commissioners have voted 3 to 2 to go back to at large voting. So you have some energy there. So the issue is fight the fight down there. And I think you can win that thing. I don't think the test of being biased will stand. If we do it, you could be the breaker of that process. Next thing. The way this Sharon Springs Alliance was handled gave me a real concern that you guys had caught Gold Dome Fever. Gold Dome Fever is like Potomac Fever. I used to do a lot of federal lobbying. People don't vote against a big bloc because they don't want to have those people against them and so forth. So we were very concerned that you guys really were impacted by all the forces we know are against you. We know that. And so you really need to make sure that we're watching that you don't catch Gold Dome Fever. Because we, our zeal put you there, we trust you. We don't think you are, but you really can't do that because you can't get away with it. Now, the second thing is, this guy really showed me he has no Gold Dome Fever. When he came out against that District 2, long-serving commissioner, that took some stones. So good job. That's what an anti-Gold Dome Fever guy was. Mike twice, would he do the same thing? He said he won't answer that question right now. We'll see if we can get him to do that down the road type of thing. But I do think talking to the candidates is a good idea, etc. So let's fight Gold Dome Fever. You know, you come back here and be able to look everybody in the eye. You put it there first, not your job, and I think you are, etc. And let's really go after this at-large voting again, because that's the way to do it. Thank you.
Thank you so much. My name is Marcy Crager, and I've lived in Forsyth County for 34 years, and I hope I live here until they take me out in the pine box. That's what my plan is. I want to thank the local delegation for your time and your interest, and I want to thank the I attended the Board of Commissioner meeting last week, and I thank you all solve a problem that your constituents are bringing to you, which is the fact of voting at large or voting through district. And I know you guys are trying to come up with a solution. If I was in a debate club, I could debate either side, but I'll tell you, having been an elected official, lived here so long, I think the solution to the problem is not adding an extra commissioner. It's not adding a super chairman or whatever. It's going back to district voting. I mean, I'm sorry, countywide voting. We need countywide yes. Ramon?
it's loose, so sorry about that. We don't know what's going on.
My name is Ramon Garcia. I just wanted to comment actually on several things. Unfortunately, rather fortunately, some people have spoken much more eloquently than I will on this topic. I kind of defer some of my comments now to Greg, who there's no way that I could be as eloquent as what he did in his speech. However, one of the things that is kind of, and Sheri, I don't know if you can kind of speak to this just in general. One of the things that is important to me is when I moved to Forsyth County, it was about 3 years ago or so, and the exponential growth has just been, and that's the one thing that I wanted to speak with about, but unfortunately the fact that I'm last on the list, you know, it's already been covered. One of the main things is Castleberry, the extension of Castleberry. That's kind of what I was speaking with in particular. And also the topic of what's going on Castleberry and Bethelview. On the other side, there were that large plot of land that they have there, the lot that is just now, it's just a kind of a wild area there. But there, and some of the other people have spoken this as well, it's clear cutting. So it looks like that's one of the things they're going to do. I know some of the ordinances, Tony has spoken about this before, they're going to try to leave some trees, you know, I don't know what size trees that they're going to try to leave or anything like that. So I haven't really kept up. But the point is, and this is one of the things that I spoke with at the meeting when the people from Kroger were there and the attorney as well. As I said, have they taken a look, and some of the other people mentioned this as well, have they taken a look at the lot that's right next to Ingalls? Right down the road, it's about half a mile away. So just wanted to find out if you can kind of just speak in general in terms of the control of the growth in Forsyth County and what we're going to try to do moving forward to kind of allow for some of the wild areas and things like that. Just kind of.
The thing is, that is completely out of my control, except that I'm a voting resident just like you, so I can vote for my commissioner and I can go to the commissioner meetings. I have no more say than you do in that. What we will be concentrating on is the laws that impact the state. So, yeah, we have no more authority in the rate of growth. We can hear, we can take your concerns to the commissioners, and that's it. We can share your feelings, and many of us do. We share a lot of the same opinions, but
I think that was that good
one. Yeah. Sorry about that. And then, Stacy, I'm going to butcher your last name, so I'm just not even going to try.
No,
Meg's going to do it. Okay. So this is Meg Norris, and I bet she says something about education.
My name is Meg Norris, and I'm a Georgia teacher, and I have spent the last 3 years fighting against the overtesting and the toxic environment that we have created in our school system and in the state. For the past 2 years, teachers and education activists have been told that all education bills would be killed at the House Education Committee level, and in fact, they were. Last week, Representative Dudgeon dismissed a group of teachers, telling them that all education legislation had to come from the governor. I don't think it works that way. This is obstruction. We have an education crisis in Georgia. There are many bills being introduced this session. They have been written by teachers, parents, and students. They are the voices of the people, not the governor's Education Reform Commission. We expect these bills to be heard. We expect these bills to be pushed. Please stand with me and the other teachers of this state and lend your voices, along with Representative Gilligan, and I hope the senator, to return education to our parents and to our teachers, and let's get the policymakers out of it.
Last, we have...
I definitely respect what Stacy said and agree 100% as far as education goes. I do want to kind of stand up for Mike Dudgeon. He did have a town hall meeting yesterday.
Where is he?
He was there earlier, but he left.
Oh, really? He left?
Yeah.
How unlike him.
The last town hall meeting we had on Thursday, we had a house full of teachers that pretty much dominated the town hall discussion. And I don't think you were here when we started, but I made the announcement that your guys' voice was heard, and today was our first session, and some of the things that you're very concerned about as far as teacher pay for performance is highly unlikely it's gonna move forward this session. And I think what Mike Dudgeon was referring to was the governor had a study committee, and a lot of, some 80-page document came out of that study committee, and some of that was turned into legislation. So, not that education has to come from the governor, but he just had a study committee, and a lot of bills came out from that study committee that the governor had out there. But it's the legislators, the House and the Senate, that are the ones that make the laws, and the governor can veto it, doesn't he?
Bambi? Kimmins? Is that right? Hello, my name is Bambi Kimmis, and I've been here for 22 years. I'm a graduate of North Georgia College of State University. I'm an old home health nurse and hospice nurse. And I started a company called Angels All Around Home Care Service 6 years ago. Does anybody know what the House Bill 183 is? Anybody? Really? It's called the Home Care Patient Protection Act. Do you know about that? No? Okay. What it does is makes all home care agencies collect taxes now since July. We've had to pay the state of Georgia taxes. And so what that has done is increased across the board the rate for every client. And I have a list here of Nathan Deal, all the taxes that have been increased for this year, for the last year. Every single one of them are up. Income tax, personal tax, corporate tax. We are struggling to stay in business to take care of your loved ones. With the population growth, our seniors, as everyone knows, the seniors are rising. So where are they going to go? Okay, where are they gonna go? One, nobody wants to go to a nursing home. Nursing homes are about $7,800 a month, okay? Two, assisted living, $3,000, $4,000. If you have dementia, $5,000, $6,000. So home care helps keep grandma, mom, dad in the home a few hours a day, go check on mom for cheaper and for longer. But now, as of July 1st, we've had to make every single caregiver an employee, okay? But we can't guarantee them work. I never know when work's gonna come in. I never know when you need help for your mom. I cannot guarantee them work. So what this is doing is that July 1st, I've had to make every single caregiver an employee when they have a subcontract mine. They work when they want, when they feel like it. Oh yeah. So. House Bill 183, it's called the Home Care Patient Protection Act. How does that protect you? How does it protect you and your families? It doesn't. It doesn't. So as of July 1st, I've had to pay the government $130,000 in taxes, which means I've had to decrease my office staff to manage the people, and I've had to increase the field staff because on July 1st, the whole entire country has made every caregiver an employee. The country has, okay? So these caregivers used to be able to work 30, 40, 50, 60, 70 hours a week, whatever they want. Well, you gotta remember, caregivers are what? Largely women. Who's the poorest group around? Women, okay? So my mission is to empower women, give them work. There's a lot, you don't have to be intelligent to be a caregiver. A lot of the caregivers are trained or educated, trained or experienced. They're not educated, okay? So I'm struggling to stay in business. And with all the taxes across the board, I'm sorry I didn't bring enough of these, but every single tax is up. Corporate tax is up 42%. Corporate payout and personal income payout, down, 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 down. But oh, listen to sales tax, it's up 2%. What's that tell you? People aren't spending money. So I just want you to be informed of House Bill 183, where there's got to be a solution. I don't know, we're increasing the tax for Georgia State and making all employees now. So if you want to say the unemployment has gone down for our area or our state, really? It's because we have to make them all employees now. So it makes us look like our numbers are going up. That's not true. These caregivers come and go. And now, okay, so they're taking care of your mom, and mom passes away after 6 months, oh, they go get unemployment. I mean, this is, I don't know if y'all know anything about this, but home care used to be able to charge $15 an hour. Now I have to charge $18 because I have to match all the taxes. Okay? And I used to have live-in caregivers to keep mom at home, right? Two caregivers. You know, one do 3 days and the other do 4 days, which I'm, no, I have to manage three people around the clock. You get 2.5 days, you get 2.5 days, you get 2 days. It's insane, and I have families yelling at me. It's just insane. So I just don't know what the solution is for our seniors. Where are they gonna go? So I just don't know what to do.
Let's
say that she was the last, but when a veteran asks me if he can come to the microphone, he gets privileged. So Chuck Von Rocker, I'll say it wrong, but come on.
I live on Castle Harry. Board of Commissioners knows me as the 92nd man, so that's how long I stand up there. I just want to say I can't take it any longer listening to all the people, and this is very nice. I moved here to Forsyth County. I've lived all over here. I raised my family in DuPage County, Illinois, which is 40 miles west of Chicago. Yep. This is the Forsyth County of the 19...
of the last 40 years.
It was one of the top counties in the country, like Forsyth County is now. Let me say this. If you want all these fancy services like we built in DuPage County, it is still one of the top counties. You're going to have to pay. You're going to have to pay for the schools. My taxes here, 5,000 square foot house, are $3,500. That house in Naperville, Illinois, $14,000 to $15,000, of which 65% of that is for the schools. Again, top schools in the country, like we have here. If you're going to want the top schools with low classmates, seats, you're going to have to pay, and you're going to pay, and you're going to pay. You want the fancy roads? The state's not going to pay. The economy's rolling over. If you think the state's going to pay, forget it. They're not. You're going to have to pay for those roads. You want the growth for the roads for all these people that are building places in here? You're going to have to pay. So you may as well get used to it. You're probably paying $2,500, $3,500 in taxes. 10 years from now, you're going to be paying double that, or you're not going to get the services. My contention is that I was an economist for a big bank. Okay, this economy is rolling over. It is going to be testy for the next 2 years. Okay, so you don't look forward to the state paying for a lot of stuff that you think you want or need. And I love this place. Anyway, thank you very much.
All of the comments that we, all the names that we had on the list. So we've heard a lot of comments. I didn't know if you wanted to do any kind of informal polling, but I would like to know if anybody at all is in favor of a single countywide chairman.
Adding a six commissioner.
So everybody is in love with adding the countywide chairman. I see that now. Is there anything else that you wanted to do an informal poll on? How many here want to see us do five commissioners all countywide?
Countywide,
yeah. You have five commissioners and they're all voted by the county. Why? Okay. Now they have to live in the district that they'd be serving, but okay. Well, thank you. Is there any other polling that you would? That was very informal, and I count on with this. Again, I want to thank you so very, very much for coming out tonight. It means a lot to us. Please stay in touch with us. Both of us have our phone numbers out there. You can contact us through any of the social media sites. We both have our cell phone numbers posted. If you want to meet any of the candidates, Kelly Warren is over there, and Rick Swope is over here. They are running for District 4 and District 2, respectively, if you want to meet them. But thank you, and have a blessed evening.